Okay, then we go to diabetes. And in fact, you're lucky in Iceland because in this 30 or 34 countries of OECD, Iceland has the lowest use of diabetic medication. And probably in your society, you are not that fat as in many other countries. Maybe you don't believe it, but if you look to the numbers, if you relate it to the other countries, you are in a quite good position. But in spite of that, you also here, you do have a lot of people with diabetes. Now, when you have diabetes in women, the clear research in Belgium was that in men, diabetes very much influences function, and in women, influences much more depression. That's Paul Enslin from Belgium did that kind of research. But you find also, if you look well, you find also some minor function changes in women, but much less than in men. You can get impaired circulation, and then you get lubrication problems. Now, lubrication problem, you don't, usually women don't complain that much, but if, in case you have a woman with diabetes, who real says, I stay so dry, that is the situation where you could try the PDE5 inhibitors. It's the same in the MS. I didn't mention about the treatment, but the PDE5 inhibitors, the Viagra, the Cialis, and the Levitra, that is the medication which can help, especially in people where it is impaired. If it's impaired in multiple sclerosis, you can give these PDE5 inhibitors, but also in the women with diabetes, you can try that also. In diabetes, you have more vaginal infections, so more candida and that kind of things. And if you get vaginal infections, that of course reduces the desire for intercourse. And that means that usually then there is much less sexuality. You can get also the peripheral neuropathy, by which she will have orgasm problems and she will feel less of the clitoris. And of course, she will have more depression, which usually means she will have less desire. Now, if you look into the man, in the man with diabetes, the most important thing is the impairment of circulation. Diabetes is mainly a circulation disease for the majority of men. So you will get very easily, you can get erectile problems in men. You get it partly by the atherosclerosis of the major arterial vessels, but you get it also by the endothelial damage inside the corpus cavernosum. And in both ways, you can get more erectile problems. Now, they found that in the man with type 2 diabetes above 65, that half of them had erectile dysfunction above 65. And depending a little bit in which country, that can be higher and can be lower. For instance, in United States, if I looked into the numbers for United States and the Netherlands, in United States, they have a much higher rate of diabetes because many more people are obese. And so they have also a much higher rate of erectile dysfunction in the United States. So that is not a good figure to relate it to Iceland. You can have also peripheral neuropathy in the man, and then he can have orgasm difficulties. It's mostly in men, they have circulation problems, and after the circulation problems, they still can have a normal orgasm. But if they get a lot of neuropathy, then it can damage also orgasm. And part of the men, they get autonomous neuropathy, and by that, they can have problems with the closing of the circular muscle between the prostate and the bladder. And it's already a rather well-known number from long ago that 1 out of 7 men in the first group where they showed this had a retrograde ejaculation. And they didn't look into that very much in the last decades. So I keep it 1 in 7, but maybe it's less. In men with diabetes, you can have also hypogonadism, especially if you look into the men who have the diabetes in combination with the metabolic syndrome, and then you get low testosterone, which means also low desire. And then you get into a vicious circle of low desire, no sex, no sex, it's no good circulation, and you continue. It's good maybe to tell now that if you have more higher T, especially if you have more frequent sex for men, more frequent sex means that they have, in a way, they use the circulation well. And that's marvelous research from Wales in a village where they do a longitudinal research, and they look into all the men in that village over every several years, and they ask everything, included sexuality. And they found that men who have 2 orgasms a week, and they related to the men who have 1 orgasm a month or less, 2 orgasms a week or more, 1 orgasm a week or a month or less, then those with 2 orgasms a week have 50% less acute myocardial death, stroke, or a brain death, stroke death. Myocardial infarction, acute myocardial death, or stroke, one of the three. So there is, and it's not a 5, it's a 50% difference. So that is, for us, very important to tell men, try, if possible, to continue to have sex, because it's healthy. It's, in a way, your usual circulation, especially for those men who don't do much other exercises in their body. Here you see what happens in diabetes and the relation between diabetes and ED. I've made this because we had in the past, we had so much the difficulty that we didn't know. Is it psychological? Is it between the ears? Or is it physical? Because in the past, if we didn't know what to do, we said it's psychological, so we send it to the psychologist. If we understand it, we can earn some money, so we treat it. But we didn't know very well what to do. So we always were fighting, is it this or is it that? And then we have discovered that, of course, it's end-end. If you look into somebody with normal erectile possibilities, and then he gets diabetes, then through the diabetes, slowly it can become less. And roughly between full erection and no more possibility to have erection, we say it's in people where it's not well corrected, the diabetes, it takes about 10 years, an interval of 10 years. Now, if you're in the middle, is it psychological or is it physical? And that's what you could explain that very clearly. 2 men with exactly the same circulation damage and exactly the same neurological damage. 1 man, he loves sex, he loves his wife, and his wife can take over, and even if he doesn't get an erection, he will have a good evening. The other man is much more nervous. He believes that he has to do the job, and he's afraid he won't get a good erection. So he takes some booze to get strong enough to get an erection, and he waits till 12:30 in the night before he starts, and then his body is so tired, so he for sure will not get an erection, so sex will be shit. They have exactly the same damage, but it's what you do with it, and that's what our function could be so well to explain that and help them to make a better sexual activity and to improve their sex life. And important, of course, especially in diabetes, for the majority of men who have a lot of circulatory erectile problems, they still can have a normal orgasm. And that's a present we can give to the patients. Just ask, and did you continue to have sex? No, because I have no erection. For many men, they always got an orgasm after having an erection. And then when the erection has gone, they stop. And they don't realize that maybe they still can have a very funny sex life. So we could help them easily. This could be part of assisting the patients in telling them to listen very well to your advice. If they are structured well in taking the insulin, etc., and the diet, and they have a good HbA1c, then they have more effect of the PDE5 inhibitors. So if they want to have sex, you can tell them, take care for the diabetes, then you can have more benefit out of Cialis or Viagra or Levitra. Okay, any question on diabetes? No questions? Then we go to the rheumatic diseases. Okay, here the major problem is the pain. Pain can be very disturbing in sexuality. For many people, if you have pain, your desire has gone. Not for everybody, few of them, they do it the other way around. It intends to impair activity and function and possibilities, etc., etc. And it can impair all three levels, desire, arousal, and orgasm. When you have pain, you get also much tension in your muscles, and the pain from one place in a joint can make so much tension that you get pain all in your body, and high tension of your muscles again is not very good for relaxed sex. And then besides that, we can get also a little bit effect of medication, and especially if we use the high dose opioids, then you get a reduction in gonadal hormones and your testosterone goes down, both again in the man and in the women, with the consequences on sexual desire again. Now, pain is a sex killer. But on the other way, you could say sex could be a painkiller. And that's what gradually we hear that a little bit more. It's even very recently, it was again, they had research on, how do you call it, the that kind of headache, migraine headache. Even in migraine headache, 50% of the people with migraine headache get less pain when they have sex and when they have an orgasm. And that's funny, because headache is used as a joke, but by many people, not to have sex. In my rehab center, I'm working in a rehab center where we have a lot of chronic pain. And we try to teach the patients that you could turn it the other way around. And the way it works is that on the one hand, everything which is distracting will give less pain. So if you have a good soccer match, or you have a complex Sudoku, or a romantic movie, or good sex, you will have less pain. But there is something additional in women. In women, in the frontal side, on the frontal side of your vagina, you have receptors, and if you stimulate those receptors, you give a message to your brain, and you make endorphins. And the endorphins can increase your pain threshold by up to 100%. Now this is what happens, and that is evolutionary, is very clearly to explain through the delivery process. But the same you can use proactively in patients, and that's what we do. We tell the patients with chronic pain, why not, instead of saying, I have pain, I don't want sex, I have pain, I want sex. Then of course, don't phone your husband who has to come to drive 1 hour and then give a lot of foreplay. Then you have to separate function from romance, from relationship, and use a good vibrator, and use the vibrator if possible inside the vagina, close to the G-spot. That is where those receptors are. And that is, old-fashioned women knew that, and they told it their daughters when they had menstruation pain. Nowadays, even gynecologists frequently don't know this, which is a pity. Now, when you have sex, it's also the muscular relaxation, it's also the increase in oxytocin, and what, as I explained, the genital stimulation. Now, dealing with pain in sex, what is important is how is a couple doing it? Because you have some husbands, especially if the woman has pain, the husband who says, no, I deserve sex, I have the right to have sex, then for sure sex will go down with high speed. The other way, the husband who is very careful, is also not good, because if he's so careful, nothing will happen. And if nothing will happen, they will have no intimacy, and she will feel very guilty. So it's, and man, we are not so very sensitive, so how to know what to do? It's not easy for us. So what is important for women, tell what you want to your male partners, to your husbands, and for men, ask what they want, because this is a very difficult thing in many relationships with pain. What we can tell them is give them advice about positions, which is, of course, for many years we didn't want to talk about positions in sexology, because when I started in sexology, we had the idea that if you can have sex in 10 different positions, you won't have a sexual problem. But that's, of course, long ago. So we didn't talk about positions, but in diseases, in rheumatic diseases, in spinal cord injury and all that things, that kind of things which you see in the rehab center, positions is very important. So we can give them advice. And what I regularly do with pieces of paper, I make with pieces of paper two patients and show them the best position, which is the scissor position, where you have the both your legs wide and do like that, which is the best position. But that's difficult to explain here without paper. I'll do that later on. Okay, up till here. Diseases can have many sexual consequences, and treatment can have many sexual consequences. So it's better to address the topic. After that, when you address the topic, we professionals, we have lots of information to share with the patients, because we know how things are running. And then probably you can give a good advice. If not, send it to the sexologists. Sexologists, they know, they have a very big box with tools to help. I'll show some of them. Providing clarity in the male-female troubles, restructuring roles, dealing with fatigue and pain. We have our own ways to deal with that. Renegotiating intimacy, dealing with loss and mourning when you have lost an important piece of your sex life. Assisting in getting new erogenic zones, teaching on tools and toys and lubricants and that kind of things, management with stoma and continence, dealing with side effects of medication, also we know very well how to deal with the side effects of antidepressants, hormonal deficiencies, we know how to deal with that, partner relation therapy sometimes, medication, lubricant, etc., etc. We know a lot, so it's good to use that. Now, this is something additional. Up till now, you don't have in Iceland people experienced in sexual medicine. We have medical sexology, you are one of them, but doctors who have a training in sexual medicine, it's something very new. We have started that some years ago, starting with the urologist on impotence, and gradually it increased and spread out, and it's now a new area. We had in December, we had the first exams in sexual medicine, so people can now become fellow in the European Committee of Sexual Medicine. They have an exam again next year in January, and they have courses, 10-day courses, and the next course is in October. I don't know yet where the course will be. And we have also a big book, and I'll give you one book for your Icelandic group, because I brought one, and it's a big one. It's 1,200 pages. Yeah, it was Durex. It's not the Durex book. It's so I think I hand it to you, and you have to take care that it's used a lot. Okay, that was my message. Any questions? How possible that there are so few males in the surrounding? I remember that 1 year ago I was giving a lecture in Iceland, and after that some of the women said, and I was explaining about male-female differences, and some of the women didn't agree with me. They said, there is no difference. One of the differences is the fact that there are so few male here. And it's not that they are not interested, but they are interested in a different way. We are building up, at least in Holland, a group of male andrologists. It's the urologist who is dealing a lot with fertility and hormones in the man. It's, let's say, the male counterpart of gynecology. And they are much more interested in male sexual health. There is in June or July, there will be a very big meeting in Berlin on male sexual health and on prostate, but also on all different kinds. And that is a very important area, and we need more men in this field as well, as role models also.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah.
In time.
Yeah, in time. Yes,
always on time.
Well, if I'm not in time, I stop early, all right? That's,